Mr. President, Guyana commends you for your stewardship of the Economic and Social Council over the past year and amidst particularly difficult global circumstances. We welcome this opportunity to further our exchanges on how to take forward sustainable and resilient recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic while accelerating implementation of the 2030 Agenda. Our responsibility to leave no one behind has never been more pressing. Therefore, our commitment and action must be proportionate to the current realities. My hope is that we agree to scale up action to address the development gains reversed by the pandemic and to accelerate progress on the sustainable development goals in this decade of action and delivery for sustainable development. Mr. President, the pandemic has laid bare the inequalities between and within countries, and the most vulnerable are now faced with many difficult development choices. The data shows that the world is experiencing its worst economic recession in 90 years. And unless there is an exponential increase in development financing, we risk another lost decade for development. Against this backdrop, our engagement at this year's high-level political forum must generate real, transformational, and sustainable solutions. As we review successes, challenges, and lessons learned, we have the opportunity to recalibrate our strategies, practices, and plans in the light of our experiences with the pandemic and consistent with the 17 SDGs and the overall 2030 Agenda as our roadmap. A high priority for middle-income countries like Guyana is the use by international financial institutions of a multidimensional vulnerability index to define development and to assess countries' progress. This is especially critical for decisions about concessional financing. Broadly speaking, our focus should remain on strengthening resilience, particularly for those vulnerable countries, so that our vulnerability to future shocks is significantly decreased. Further, the economic, environmental, and social dimensions of sustainable development should receive equal attention in our targeted efforts. Mr. President, I take this opportunity to briefly expound on some of the initiatives that the government of Guyana has been engaged in to further the achievement of the SDGs under consideration at this year's high-level political forum. I underscore, however, the integrated and indivisible nature of the SDGs and note that development must be measured holistically across all of the goals. First, recognizing the need to scale up efforts to eliminate hunger and curb poverty, His Excellency President Mohamed Irfan Ali, in his capacity as lead head of state responsible for agriculture in CARICOM, is spearheading the CARICOM Agri-Food Systems Agenda, which prioritizes regional food security and nutrition. Given the interconnected economic, environmental, and social dimensions of food systems, it is expected that strong food systems are critical not only to eliminating hunger, but for addressing several of the sustainable development goals. On this note, Guyana looks forward to the convening of the Food Systems Summit in September 2021, and the momentum it has induced translating into concrete actions for the transformation of the world's food systems. Secondly, Mr. President, the pandemic has compelled all of us to place a laser focus on health and well-being, particularly on our capacity to meet the healthcare needs of our populations. We are committed to providing the best health services for our population and recognize that we have a special responsibility towards those who are most vulnerable, including the elderly, women, and children. We are keen on ensuring that people receive the healthcare they need, particularly at this juncture, and are committed to further modernizing of our healthcare system. As part of this thrust, we have expanded our procurement for drugs and medical supplies and plan to modernize the delivery of mental health services, among other initiatives. Thirdly, as a low-lying coastal state, Guyana has a keen interest in addressing the climate emergency in a frontal manner. For countries such as Guyana, climate change represents an existentialist threat which requires very strong mitigation and adaptation efforts across the globe. As such, the government of Guyana is continuing on a low-carbon development trajectory premised on our desire to pursue economic development while combating climate change. Our objective is to provide a pathway to prosperity and development that is non-polluting. Further, we aim to provide a model to the world of a low-carbon and resilient development can be possible and beneficial for forested countries. We recognize that in order to reduce inequalities, we must ensure that our resources are sustainably and equitably managed. And these are some of the principles underpinning our low-carbon development model. I must here underscore the importance of increasing and improving access to international climate finance, especially for small islands developing states. We must emphasize that the pledge to provide $100 million for climate finance by 2020 for developing countries has not been realized, and reiterate the urgent need for this solemn promise to be fulfilled. Additionally, technology transfer, capacity building, and advancing the rules governing the trade in carbon credits are priorities for countries like Guyana. Moreover, and collectively, ambitions must be increased as reflected in nationally determined contributions under the Paris Agreement if we are to lower greenhouse gas emissions to achieve global warming targets. It is imperative that we make significant progress on many of these issues at the upcoming 26th session of the United Nations Climate Change Conference of the Parties, COP26. Finally, the government continues to redouble its efforts in creating a society built on strong institutions, the rule of law, good governance, and democracy, made even more imperative as Guyana is on a cusp of significant economic transformation with the addition of the oil and gas sector. The government of Guyana is of the firm conviction that people thrive best in democratic societies, and we continue to be conscious in the measures we employ to ensure that democratic tenets remain the hallmarks of our society. Notably, we have created a Ministry of Parliamentary Affairs and Governance and have increased budgetary allocations to a suite of constitutional agencies. Further, we have also begun the process of constitutional and electoral reform. We are also providing opportunities for equality, equitable education, and lifelong learning for all, with a view of positioning all of our citizens to fully contribute to the development of our nation. On this note, the government of Guyana is implementing an initiative whereby 20,000 tertiary-level online scholarships will be offered to our citizens over a five-year period to pursue higher education. More qualified citizens will mean greater access to job opportunities and higher levels of output. These initiatives are critical for the preservation of peaceful societies, an important prerequisite for sustainable development. Mr. President, like others, we underscore that partnerships remain critical for achieving the SDGs, and our hope is that together we can find new ways of working together for people and the planet, for prosperity and for peace. Guyana stands in solidarity with all countries dealing with the multiple challenges occasioned by the COVID-19 pandemic, particularly the most vulnerable countries. We sincerely hope that these groups of countries can receive the necessary support to recover and to build forward better. I conclude by commending those countries that have presented their voluntary national reviews and wish to advise that Guyana is already working towards the preparation for its second review. I thank you.